Good morning. We are so very happy that you have joined us this day for this hour of worship. This is the fifth Sunday of the season of Easter. I want to, as in other weeks, continue to give my thanks to all those in this congregation and around this city who are stepping up to help each other, to extend our hands in Christian love in these uncertain times. In our service on May the 24th, we will be having the closest thing that we can enact to South End's song service, which we share in two or three times a year. We often have hymn requests taken from the congregation, but this time we're asking that you, if you have a request for a hymn to be sung that day, that you email it to pastor@southendumc.org or call in and leave a message on the church office phone, 615-833-2077, or you can write it on a note and send it to the church. We would love to have your input for this service. And now I would ask that we prepare our hearts and our minds for worship. May the words of our mouths spoken, sung, and prayed, and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable to God, who is our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. Join me now in the opening prayer. Eternal light, shine into our hearts. Eternal goodness, deliver us from evil. Eternal power, be our support. Eternal wisdom, scatter the darkness of our ignorance. Eternal pity, have mercy upon us. With all our heart and mind and soul and strength, we may seek your peace and be brought by your infinite mercy to your holy presence. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Hello, and let me start today by saying we are extremely thankful, we are extremely happy, grateful, and blessed that you have found us and that you are joining us today in our worship service. We also do say that doubly for the limited amount of our worship team that are here and able to make this possible and those behind the scenes that you do not see. We want to invite you, if you are not a member of this congregational community, that as we resume another sense of stability and being able to worship together in the coming weeks, that you will at least visit us, come and join us, and see that we are a very warm, loving, open, and safe sanctuary church for you to have a place to worship. We'll be glad to elbow bump, hacky sack kick, or bow to greet you in any way that you deserve. I can almost hear you singing as the words appear of the hymns on the screen. Now I invite you, as the scripture appears, that we read responsively Psalm 1. Please read with us. Blessed are those who do not walk in the counsel of the wicked,
or stand in the way of sinners, or sit in the seat of scoffers.
But their delight is in the law of the Lord.
On God's law they meditate day and night.
They are like trees planted by streams of water that yield their fruit in season, and their leaves do not wither.
In all they do, they prosper.
The wicked are not so, but they are like chaff which the wind drives away.
Therefore the wicked will not stand in the judgment, nor sinners in the congregation of the righteous.
For the Lord knows the way of the righteous, but the way of the wicked will perish. Thanks be to God. May the Lord add his blessing to the reading of this word.
Again, I would ask that the children who may be there with the family, if you would come a little closer to the computer screen, I'd love to talk with you. Today we're going to talk about and listen to the scripture where Jesus said that he was a vine and we are branches. And I don't know about you, but I've never thought of a grown person being a plant, but that's okay, because lots of times Jesus teaches us things that we aren't supposed to take literally, but we're supposed to think about. So I have a question for you. How many times have you tried to do something all by yourself? I can remember my children wanting to tie their own shoes or put on all their clothes when we were hurrying and trying to get out the door. And one time I remember when I was grown up, I was away from home for the first time. I was working at a new job, and it was winter time, and I was about 1,000 miles from home. And all of a sudden, my car just wouldn't go anymore. And it was starting to get late in the afternoon, and I was all alone on a snowy road. Well, thankfully, I had something called AAA. But anyway, I could make a phone call, and somebody, there were no cell phones then, so I had to wait for somebody to come along the road and make, go into the next town and make a phone call, which they did, and then the trucks came and helped me get my car started. So, you know, sometimes we would love to be able to do things all by ourselves, but we actually need the help of somebody bigger or stronger or who has different kind of skills or knowledge than we do. Well, Jesus said, I want you, no matter how old you are, adult or teenager or child, to be able to love the way that God would want us to love. And sometimes that's not easy. That's very, very seldom easy to do all by ourselves. So Jesus said, look, I'm going to give you the power to do it. I'm going to show you how. I'm going to be, more important, I'm going to be with you every time you're in a difficult situation and you really don't want to share, or you don't want to just maybe be kind to this person, or you maybe just should keep not say anything, or whatever it is. Jesus is saying, you don't have to be able to do this all by yourself. I've got your back. I'm right there with you, just sort of like the vine, and we're connected, the branches. We can't do anything without that big old stem, that vine. Jesus says, I am always there with you, and I will help you, not just help you, but I will give you the power and the strength and the courage to do what God has asked us to do. And oh my word, that is just so wonderful to know that no matter what time of day or night or what time of year or wherever we are or whatever age we are, Jesus is always there, willing and wanting to help us do what God has asked us to do. Let's pray. Dear God, we thank you this day that we're not alone, no matter what age we are. We can't do everything by ourselves, and we can't even love the way you want us to love, clearly, not all by ourselves. It's just so wonderful, God, to realize that Jesus is standing right beside us all the time. And we give you thanks and praise for this. Amen.
Thank you.
Today is Mother's Day, and it is not a church holiday or celebration, but it is clearly one that is on our minds, I'm sure, this Sunday, as we are not usually able to gather the way we would normally do. But clearly, the gospel of lesson today speaks volumes about love. Love within our families, love within our community, love within our world. And so, hear these words, please, from the 15th chapter of the Gospel of John. It is a familiar one, and it is entitled in the Bible, Jesus the True Vine. I am the true vine, and my Father is the vine grower. He removes every branch in me that bears no fruit. Every branch that bears fruit, he prunes to make it bear more fruit. You have already been cleansed by the word that I have spoken to you. Abide in me as I abide in you. Just as the branch cannot bear fruit by itself unless it abides in the vine, neither can you unless you abide in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. Those who abide in me and I in them bear much fruit, because apart from me, you can do nothing. Whoever does not abide in me is thrown away like a branch and withers. Such branches are gathered, thrown into the fire, and burned. If you abide in me and my words abide in you, ask for whatever you wish, and it will be done for you. My Father is glorified by this, that you bear much fruit and become my disciples. As the Father has loved me, so I have loved you. Abide in my love. If you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. I have said these things to you so that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be complete. This is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. No one has greater love than this, to lay down one's life for one's friends. You are my friends if you do what I command you. I do not call you servants any longer, because a servant does not know what the master is doing. But I have called you friends, because I have made known to you everything that I have heard from my Father. You do not choose me. You do not choose me, but I choose you. And I appoint you to go and bear fruit, fruit that will last, so that the Father will give you whatever you ask him in my name. I am giving you these commands so that you may love one another. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. That's a whole lot of scripture, and Jesus said a whole lot of things there. This part of John, the second part of John, is where Jesus is, as we say, preaching to the choir. The first half of the Gospel of John, Jesus has been teaching by using the word signs, by the miracles that he has, and sort of long, almost sort of sermons. But at this end, chapter 13, 14, 15, 16, and 17, Jesus is talking with his disciples because he knows that once he leaves them in physical body, once he has gone to his death, that they will need to remember the things that he has taught them. And so, as Jesus has spoken a number of times about being something else, what we call a metaphor, he speaks here about a vine and branches. You know, I need to be reminded what a metaphor is sometimes. A figure of speech used to make comparison between two things, they're not alike. But in comparing them, it gives a deeper meaning to something, especially that's symbolic or abstract. And a metaphor is not meant to be taken literally. So many things that Jesus said, especially in the Gospel of John, we need to like sort of take in and sit with and think about a lot. And this is one of them. Jesus said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life, the bread of life, the living water, the resurrection, the true vine, the light of the world, and the good shepherd." And it makes us remember, makes us think back to the story of Moses, as he was being called by God to go back to Egypt, where he had escaped with his life. And God is asking him to go back and deliver his people out of slavery. And he hears God's voice asking him to do this while he is keeping sheep, and there is a bush that catches on fire but does not burn up. And obviously, Moses realizes that this is not something normal. And the voice is speaking to him, and so he says to this voice, "Who am I to say to the people that you are, that is going to call us out of Egypt?" And God responds, "I am who I am." And so in the Gospel of John, whenever Jesus talks about "I am," the people in his community, the people who heard him speak, would immediately think back to the way God defined himself to Moses. For you see, Jesus is saying, "I am more than a sage, a prophet, a great teacher. I am God here in the flesh," even if you cannot take that in yet. And so we respond to this metaphor, this thing of farming and vineyards. And the vine is a wonderful way to talk about abiding. Abiding. Jesus says we are to abide with him as he is the vine and we are the branches. And the purpose of that is to produce fruit. Fruit that lasts. Well, I don't know about you, but in these days when everything has been so turned upside down, I tend to think about how we're all connected. And one of the ways that we're connected is by this diagram, which is very obvious to most of us adults and most children. There's some people in charge, and then there's other folks that are a little bit less in charge, and then there's others that have their own areas of work. Sort of a corporate model, a government model, even a hierarchical church model. And you know what? For some things and for some parts of our lives, especially when those roles are filled by good people with integrity, there's a lot of things that get done. It's also a model that can cause some real problems, well, because we're humans. And then there's this idea of a mobile. And I often think of that now, and because things that I've often taken for granted, like the things that people do in their lives with their jobs that we often take for granted, except in times like these. Being able to turn on the light switch and we have electricity, when in Nashville, how many thousands of people in this past week had no electricity for days? When we go to the store and just get groceries, whatever we can afford that at that time. We turn on the tap and there is clean water. Or we have a cell phone. How does that even work? How many times do we think about the trace metals that have to go into that, or the towers and the broadband access and the cables even that are laid on the bottom of the ocean connecting the continents. I don't think about that stuff very often. But right now, I tend to think about the imbalances that people are going through. And we even think about the farmers right now, where people are going hungry because they've lost their jobs, but the dairy farmers have had to discard gallons and gallons of milk because they normally sold them to restaurants and schools. There's so many people that we depend upon. And when part of that balance is disrupted, our lives are pretty disrupted. Well, those two kinds of connections, we don't have much control over, really. This kind of a connection, where folks in the body of Christ or in a team where folks have decided to work together, side by side, we do have control over. Those are the kinds of decisions that we make. So I go back to this vine. In this 15th chapter of John, Jesus has promised to abide with you and I, all who are willing and wanting to follow Jesus and to serve God. And to abide here really does mean that if we want to be those who bear fruit, the fruit of abundant life, the fruit of justice, the fruit of righteousness and kindness and compassion and mercy and forgiveness as God defines them, then we really do need to be connected to the vine. If you cut off a branch, it doesn't do anything. And on the other hand, if you have a vine with no branches, it doesn't do anything either. And in nature, neither of them occur without one without the other. So this was very obvious to the people that Jesus was talking to. But Jesus goes quite a bit further. And one of the things that made me think as I was reading for this and thinking and studying and praying is that Jesus says we are no longer servants, but we are called by him friends. And then he says, whatever you will ask the Father in my name will be done for you. Well, Willimon, in his book, which I've spoken about numbers of times in these last number of weeks, thank God it's Thursday, said, you know, this is not an isolated verse talking about the absolute power of prayer. In this context, Jesus is saying, whatever you pray for and asking help for bearing fruit that will last, my Father will grant that. And so Jesus says, calls us friend, and we are reminded that a friend is someone who knows us, the good friends, the true friends, someone who knows us deeply, someone who stands by us and also will not let go of us very easily, and someone who will talk to me or tell me the hard things that maybe I don't want to hear, holding me accountable in love, part of a relationship. Jesus calls me friend. Jesus says to his disciples, I have shared with you everything that the Father has shared with me. I have given you all that you can understand. And then Jesus says, abide in me. As God loves me, so I loved you. Abide in that love. If you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love and you will experience joy. So here we are. We are called to bear fruit. And here I think Jesus, we in our centuries since Jesus really need to look at this probably both as individuals, but mostly as the church, in all of its failings and imperfections, and as a vehicle of God's grace. We are called as friends. We are called, and we must choose whether we will abide in Christ's love and follow those commandments. I don't know about you, but there are times in my life when I'd rather not hear the call of Jesus. In fact, I was so taken one time years ago, as I was studying and writing a paper on Jesus. And I remember reading in one of Dorothy Solo's books, she was a German theologian after World War II, and she had been asking people to tell her what Jesus meant to them. And the one I was struck by was the German man who said, "Jesus is the one who disturbs my life. Disturbs my life in such a transformative way." Maybe at times I feel like the commitment to abiding in Jesus and in that love is either too costly or too much relationship work. And then we come thinking about Jesus, the branches being pruned off. And so many times I think in our own mindsets, in our own human frailty, we project that on other folks. But if we go back to this metaphor, we in the church are not those who prune folks out. It's God who prunes. And pruning isn't necessarily a negative thing. Any healthy plant that's going to have optimal harvest is going to have some pruning. Yes, maybe we can choose not to abide, and maybe we allow ourselves to die. But that isn't that, and Jesus acknowledges that. And so I would say to us as the church that perhaps our lack of bearing fruit has nothing to do with the rest of us, has nothing to do with God, but has a lot to do with our faithfulness. Well, Willimon, in this same book, said, "I once sent a pastor to a pitiful, moribund congregation in the eastern part of my conference. And upon her arrival, she told the congregation that one of her particular ministerial gifts was ministry with children, having earned her master's degree in early childhood education before attending seminary. Their response? He said, quote, "We haven't had a children's Sunday school class in over a decade. No children." But this bishop says, "When I visited the congregation a year later, I was thrilled to discover two children's ministry groups and a total of more than 20 children." So he said, "I asked the pastor, 'What'd you do to get these results?' And she replied, 'I prayed. I told the Lord, if you want this church to have a future, you'll have to do it. Please, Lord, send us some of your kids so they can be our kids. And we promise to do the rest.' In only 6 months of continuous prayer, we got our first young family. The Lord had made good on his promise. The Father will give you fruit if you ask him in my name." And then he said one more example. "I also had a church that was in serious decline, primarily due to constant congregational conflict." And I'm not saying this is not Southend, but the example is a good one. He said, "For a long time," the pastor, he's quoting the pastor there, "for a long time we have prayed to God to heal our divisions, to give us peace and harmony as a church." And then this bishop said, "Though I didn't think of John 15 at the time or fast enough, I ought to have replied, 'Don't pray for healing and harmony. Pray for God to make good on a promise for fruit. If you bear fruit, the healing and harmony will take care of themselves.'" if you bear fruit of love, of kindness, of abundance, in God's definition, there will be harmony. To love as Jesus has loved, to bear fruit, is nothing romanticized or sentimental or emotional. It's about loving in real time, and sometimes the hardest places there are family, extended family, or co-workers or neighbors. But it also extends to those who have more status than we do and those who have less, those we know maybe all too well, and the strangers in the situations that we may only hear about. And I think that we are called to see in the larger structures around us the things that harm or hurt ourselves and others. One of the things that bothers me the most right now in our world is the people being either forced to go back to work or encouraged to go back to work. Jobs that so many people depend on and may have low pay. But in a number of situations, these folks have no sick leave and no health benefits. And yet, we want them for us to go back to work. On the other hand, there's the grocer or the grocery chain who has decided to go to farmers regionally, buy up a lot of excess milk, and donate it to overwhelmed food banks. We make choices, don't we? Do you and I choose to abide in Christ's love? To be part the branch and that which produces fruit? He calls us as friends, and sometimes friends, the good friends, ask us to do some of the hardest things. And so I would say that abiding in the vine as a branch impacts all of us. It is a sign of hope in these days. And if anything, it contributes to all of that which is our future story. If our goal as the Christian church is to love others as Jesus loved us, then we better absolutely, absolutely be ready to abide in Christ's love, to be connected to that vine. And the last part that helps me picture this is a quote by Gail O'Day from the commentary of New Interpreter's Bible. She said it's this sort of image of the church, this metaphor, stands against what we in Western culture value so highly, and that's personality, self-expression, and individualism. And she said, but the distinctiveness of the faithful church in the world derives solely from its relationship to God and Jesus, not the characteristics or even the gifts of its members, but its connection. The mark of the faithful community is how it loves, not who its members are. There is only one gift, she says, and that is to bear fruit. And any branch can do that if it remains in Jesus. Any branch. No matter where we are, what age we are, whether we're at home, whether we are feeling isolated there, whether we are on the front lines, whether we are working at home, whether no matter where we are and in whatever time, if we stay connected to that vine, we can and we will bear fruit. And that's what Jesus is asking us to do. It's our choice. May we choose well. Amen. As we come to our time of prayer, we lift up joys and concerns, and as in our normal times when folks would be here in the sanctuary, we lift up, we give folks a chance to give voice to their concerns. And so I would ask all of us, as you are coming to this time of prayer, that you bring to your mind and your heart those folks and situations that you give thanks for, that you lift up to God in concern, and especially our whole families, where love and acceptance may be part of not only the celebration of this weekend of Mother's Day, but of the health and the fullness of love that should be in each family. And I would ask now for the chair of our staff parish relations committee to give us an announcement.
Thank you, Ann. As most of you know, our pastor, Ann Cover, will be retiring at the end of June. We've been blessed by Ann's leadership, and we give thanks for all that she has meant to each of us in this congregation. We'll keep her in our hearts and in our prayers as she enters into the next phase of her life. Bishop Bill McAlealy and the Nashville Area Cabinet of the Tennessee-Memphis Conference have been working prayerfully in the last few weeks to make missional appointments to every church in our conference. Today, I am able to announce that our new pastor will be Reverend Sam Ordung, O-R-D-U-N-G, Sam Ordung. His first Sunday with us will be August the 2nd because of the pandemic, and we are very fortunate that Ann has offered to stay and offer us leadership through the month of July. We are extremely grateful for that. Reverend Ordung is 33 years old. His wife's name is Carissa. He's currently serving a three-point charge in the Caney Fork River Conference, in addition to being a chaplain in the Army Reserve. We look forward to welcoming the Reverend and Mrs. Ordung and serving the Lord together with them. Now I would ask you to join me in prayer. Lord Jesus Christ, we give you thanks for our church and for blessing us with the leadership of Ann Cover, our pastor, our teacher, our leader, and our friend in Christ. May your grace be upon her and her family in the life adventure that lies ahead. As Sam Ordung comes to be our next pastor, we pray that your grace may abound in his life, giving peace, joy, and confidence in this new beginning. Open our hearts and minds to receive the gifts you have for us in these days as we give thanks for what has been and anticipate what will be. Our life is in you, O God, and through the Holy Spirit we pray this day. Amen.
We pray in the name of the Father Jesus, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. I also want to give thanks for all that has been given in time and loving service, but also financially. Our church finances are still tight, but we are making do, and much has been given for the food program and for the Good Neighbor Fund, and it is allowing us to continue on here now and for the future, and at the same time helping those who are in dire need. And I give great thanks for everyone.
come at my heart burdened be, then I am still and wait here in the silence until you come and sit a while with me. You raise me up so I can stand on mountains. You raise me up to walk on stormy seas. I am strong when I am on your shoulders. Raise me up. Stand on mountains. You raise me up to walk on stormy seas. I am strong when I am on your shoulders. You raise me up to more than I can be. Raise me up so I can stand on mountains. You raise me up to walk on stormy seas. I am strong when I am on your shoulders. Raise me up to more than me up so I can stand on mountains. You raise me up to walk on stormy seas. I am strong when I am on your shoulders. Raise me up to more than I can be. Thank you.
Now may the love of God, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the communion and fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with each of us, now and into life everlasting. Amen.